Dr. Tom Marshburn will be making his second flight and his first long-duration stay aboard the station as well. His first flight was as a crew member on STS-127, which flew back in July of 2009 to the ISS. And in fact, we do have an opportunity to talk to Dr. Marshburn. He is, as I mentioned, in Star City, awaiting a departure for Baikonur on Thursday. Good morning, Tom. You there?
Hey, good morning, Kyle. Good to hear your voice. Yep, I'm here.
Hey, it's great. Great to talk to you. I appreciate you joining us here in the control center for a few minutes to talk about all the work that's been going on, your training, and basically what got you here to be ready to go. It probably doesn't feel like that it's actually here now, huh?
Oh, you're absolutely right. You know, 2.5 years of training overall, and it's for the last few months, it's been a series of finals, final exams in the U.S. in the early fall, and then final exams here in Russia for the Soyuz and the Russian segment studies. We've been saying goodbye to our instructors as we go from to each training center, so it's been a bit of an emotional step down each time. So we're a bit used to it, but now it's starting to dawn on us that we're going to launch in about 2 weeks, and we're getting very excited about it.
Yeah, I bet. We're going to have a top opportunity, I think, to talk to Chris tomorrow. But you have a kind of a special background because you're obviously a medical doctor, and in fact, you actually have worked in probably both control centers, right? You supported shuttle flights when you were a flight surgeon here at NASA on this side. And then you also supported one of our Mir crew members from that control center over there, correct?
That's right. It, really unique experience, a chance that a few people get to get. I was sitting surgeon console for shuttle flights and for station flights, but I was one of the prime capsule communicators, which is a rare for a non-astronaut. I was a flight surgeon at the time. From the Mission Control Center in Moscow. And that happened simply because we didn't have a lot of NASA personnel at the time over here in Moscow. So for most of the U.S. astronauts that flew to the Mir space station in the 90s, I got to talk to them from the Mission Control Center. Very interesting to see the way the two control teams work together. A lot of similarities, a lot of overlap, but also a good number of differences. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, I bet. And so then you became an astronaut, so you've had that background working with all the flight controllers, and of course you flew, as I mentioned, you know, leading in to discussion back on Endeavour on the 2JA mission, which on that flight you did 3 spacewalks, I believe, and so you've got that experience too. But what do you take from your flight then and now looking forward to going back to the station, only this time long duration? I mean, as a medical doctor, that's got to be, I won't say a lifelong dream, but certainly something that is very beneficial to your background.
Oh, yeah. As a flight surgeon, we would, one of the jobs of the flight surgeon is to imagine what it's like to be in space. You're treating astronauts, and the best flight surgeons are the ones that are able to sort of predict, even though they're never able to get there, predict what it's going to be like for the astronaut and predict what the challenges, the physical, physiologic challenges are going to be. And we do that by interviewing astronauts when they come back as part of their medical record, part of a medical debrief. So very exciting to get up there myself, and a number of flight surgeons have been selected as astronauts. Mike Barrett's another. And to get up there and to actually be able to experience it ourselves, it gives a huge amount of insight. What it feels like when you hit zero gravity for the first time, the rush of fluids to the head, what it feels like to have just the sensory overload of floating in space and having important things to do right away. So what I'm looking forward to on this long-duration flight, which will be unique for me, is to feel my body adapt. I hear it takes a good month for the body to adapt to zero gravity. So I'm going to be experiencing that, and then over the flow of several months, what it will feel like to live in a confined area, to have similar surroundings during that time. I'm just looking forward to seeing what happens. I'll be keeping a journal and making observations the whole way.
Has Roman given you, or other crew members that have launched on a on a Soyuz versus a space shuttle given you any differences to sort of look forward to, or do they kind of tell you it's, you want to experience it on your own and don't give you a whole lot of information?
Get a little bit of information, particularly from the astronauts that did flow shuttle, because very few Russians have flown shuttle and Soyuz. But the astronauts that have gone before me that have flown to the station that have flown shuttle and then Soyuz understand that the Soyuz launch, while it's similar in duration to a shuttle launch for time from the ground to getting on orbit, understand that the Soyuz launch is a little bit smoother. Those solid rocket boosters on the shuttle really give you a good shaking, and you can feel the power of those things lifting the shuttle and its external tank off the pad and up out of the atmosphere. So I suspect similar G-forces, but not quite as much shaking around. I'll tell you what I'm really looking forward to is the living space inside the Soyuz. You may know that it's very tiny for three people in the living area, or in the landing, little gumdrop-shaped craft, and then there's a living area. Both of them together are not much bigger than a closet, particularly with equipment stuffed in there. So I suspect it's going to be a little bit like the Mercury and Gemini astronauts, perhaps the Apollo astronauts experienced on launch, the same confined living. We're only going to be that way for about 2 days, but I'm very much looking forward to that, and it'll be a huge piece of history that I'm getting to experience there.
Yeah, no kidding. Obviously, expedition scheduled probably for about the same as the three guys that are up there right now, about 147 days or so, if all goes as it's currently planned. And your shuttle flight obviously was 10 days, and that was, you know, as some people, I guess, have sort of described it as a 100-yard dash versus what you're going to do now, because it gives you an opportunity to spread out and actually live in space. And you've got to be looking forward to the contrast in those two based on your first flight to this one.
Yeah, you know, there is so much work going on up there right now, particularly in the laboratories with we're going to have 130 scientific experiments going on while I'm there. People coming back over the last couple of years have said, you know, it's really more like a 6-month sprint and not a marathon anymore. Although they're coming back very happy and a little bit sad to leave. The work-rest schedule, while the work is intense, there's enough rest to recharge batteries. And you're right. I think there will be a few times. I think there was only a 45-minute period during my shuttle flight. We were docked to station about 10 days, but we were up there for 16. But so busy the entire time that 45-minute period where I got to look out the window and just experience the joy of zero gravity other than the day-to-day work. So I think there will be more time on my long-duration flight to enjoy that and to get to be an expert, too, at navigating through the modules. We were very impressed when we arrived on the shuttle with the long-duration colleagues that greeted us as we came over the hatch. They were very good at not running into things and very smoothly floating about the cabin and in complete control all the time, whereas we were still a bit like a baby deer on ice. So I'm looking forward to being an expert there.
Yeah, I bet. And, of course, the station is a little bit bigger than what it was when you were there. Your flight was in July of 2009, and the other components that were delivered were not massive modules, but certainly have added to the size since you were there. You and Chris are scheduled for a couple of spacewalks right now during your expedition?
We are not scheduled for any right now. We did train for some, and as it's always happens in space flight, you got to make a plan, but the plan can change on you. So those space flights have moved into the future out of our expedition. However, who knows? You know, we've trained to handle any contingency that comes up on the outside of the space station. So we are prepared to go out there, and we're going to act as if we are going to do a spacewalk, that is in terms of staying fit and keeping our upper bodies fit, keeping our mind sharp for EVA if we do indeed need to go out the hatch. So we're looking forward to that, and we'll just see what happens. You know, the Node 3 was added, and the PMM were added after I spent my time on the space station. And the Node 3, as you know, has the cupola. So I can't wait to get up there and get a look out the cupola.
Yeah, I bet. In terms of spacewalk training, that's, you made actually a good point there, because like for shuttle flights, you had a ton of time leading up to a shuttle flight to train for the spacewalks, because you knew you were going to do those spacewalks because that was part of your mission. And now if one gets called up while you're up there, it's a whole different kind of training, in terms of it's kind of paper training or electronic training and voice training with your EVA team on the ground. But obviously, you mentioned that you guys train for generic type spacewalks. So if you do get asked to do a spacewalk, it would be a little bit different in terms of that experience. But you've already had EVA training, and so it's got to help you, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that helps. It makes a huge difference. There are certain things that you just cannot get in your ground-based training that you can only get with the actual experience. I would say the three main things are the view. You can't recreate that on Earth, and that does affect you in the sense that you have to keep your mind off the view and on your work. The temperature changes are quite intense in space. You have to adjust your temperature on the dark side. I got the chills when I was on the dark side of the Earth in the shadow of the station when we're on the light side of the Earth, when I was holding on to a metal platform for quite a while. And start to lose the feeling in your fingers because you get chilled enough. So learning how to take care of that, taking care of that early on, and experiencing that as extra overhead to your work, that's all part of the experience of having done it, which I could apply to my future spacewalks. And then just the overhead of being out there, understanding the dangers associated with spacewalk, the dangers associated with making sure your safety tether doesn't get fouled up, being cognizant of where you really are in the vacuum of space with just your thin spacesuit on, all of those things add up to the actual experience. So I think having been out there does make a big difference. The astronaut corps and the training teams are well aware of this issue with the inability to train for an actual spacewalk that may occur if something just suddenly breaks on the space station. So for that reason, they've given us generic training. I'm confident with using any tool that they ask us to use, working with any component that's out there. So we'll just have to see what happens.
So describe now, as you mentioned, that you guys are getting ready to head to Baikonur for your launch in a couple of weeks. And you guys were just, I guess, certified, maybe that's the wrong word, but again, approved, I guess, as a crew to go, but kind of lay out your template from now and until a launch day on the 19th.
Yeah, and actually, that is the word they use, certified, and they're very clear we are certified to go into quarantine. We've got a few more medical checks before we are certified for launch, and that won't happen until the moment before we walk out to the pad, and that's when our backup crew is off duty. They're no longer our backup crew when they say goodbye to us on the launch pad. So that's the moment in which we are absolutely certified to go. But we're going to leave. You're right on the 6th, this Thursday. There's going to be 2 weeks when we are allowed a lot of administrative time, just going over our notes, reviewing our flight data file, our instructions for flying the Soyuz. I'm going to use the time to think about moment by moment what my actions are going to be. It's like a lot of things, I suppose. If it starts off well, it seems to go well over time. So we'll spend some time going over all the minute details of our first few days on orbit. Very importantly, just sending emails to family and friends. Family will be allowed to visit us, so we'll have some very poignant and important moments with my wife and daughter and the rest of my family while I'm in quarantine. So be doing that, and otherwise just staying physically fit, getting ready to go.
Yeah, I was gonna ask you about family, you know, because that's obviously a very important part of you know, the job that you do, because it's kind of a team effort when you make decisions and such. And you know, how do y'all talk about, you know, and obviously being an astronaut is ingrained in an entire family, but you know, obviously you don't make decisions alone. So how did y'all talk about, hey, I'm going to be assigned, or I want to go do this long duration flight, so I'll be gone for a few months?
Yeah, well, my wife and I talked about it after my shuttle flight. And we started to discuss, what if I were assigned for a long duration flight, and how would that impact us? And we talked about it and the difficulties of being away, and felt like, you know, quite frankly, others have done it before us. Members of the military go away for that long or longer. So we felt like it's important. It's important for our country. It's an honor to do it. So we agreed that if I were asked, then I would go ahead and enter the training. As it so happened, after that discussion, about 2 weeks later, I got an email from the chief of the astronaut corps, and the email said, better get studying on your Russian. It was a one-line email, and that was it. And I thought, all right, well, it looks like an assignment might be coming up here pretty soon. And I was right. Early, you know, just a couple more weeks, I got an assignment.
Obviously, the one big announcement that's occurred in the last couple of weeks while you guys are in your final days of training there in Star City is this the one-year increment that has just come up. And I don't know if you have any thoughts on that. As obviously, being a medical doctor, it's an important step, I would think, to transition from, at least on the U.S. side, from the long days that we've had, which is maybe on the order of 200, to, you know, something more than a year as you look toward possible human travel beyond low Earth orbit.
Oh, yeah. It's important to understand the limits of what humans can do. Now, we're also talking at a cellular level. We think we know the rate of atrophy of muscle, bone, nerve, cardiovascular system, but we've only had very few people be up in space for that long a time. More data is better in that regard. But I think very importantly, we need to understand what we don't even know yet, what we don't know is a problem. You may have heard about the eyesight problems that are coming up, potentially due to increased intracranial pressure around the fluid around the brain that goes up. We never would have known that was an issue unless we continued to fly people on long-duration flight. And now we know it's a pretty big deal, and we need to figure out what's going on there. It's important for exploration. And so who knows what we're going to find out on this one-year mission. Hopefully we'll find out that humans are just as robust as we think they are, but it'll certainly be interesting from the scientific standpoint.
Well, on a lighter note, obviously you're up there obviously performing all of these experiments and studying the human body for long duration stays and all that, but there's also downtime, and I know in your bio it does mention that you like playing the guitar, and we all know that Chris Hadfield obviously does. So are you guys planning on any concerts up there?
Yeah, you know, we play different styles of music. I'm not a singer, but I'm a classical guitarist, and Chris is a great performer and singer and guitarist. So our different styles may very well come together up there. I would like to contribute to some musical pieces. You know, we'll see. If he's got the time, I'm sure I would enjoy it. I think there's one guitar only up there, so we'll have to lay down tracks or figure out something because we can't both play at the same time. Or maybe I'll figure out drums or something. But I've got a number of things I'm going to be working on. I'm going to be keeping a journal. I think Chris will be the music man up there, but if I can help out, then I'd love to.
Well, that's great. I mean, it's obviously one thing about life in space. It's the same as on the ground. You do have to balance your life, and we're really looking forward to you guys getting up there and joining Kevin, Oleg, and Evgeny, and really appreciate you taking time to talk to us here in Mission Control for a few minutes, and we're looking forward to your launch on the 19th. Thanks a lot for joining us, Tom.
I enjoyed it. Thanks very much. Appreciate it.
Take care.
Bye-bye.